Okay, so first off, I swear I did not look at Andy's slides in advance. You're not going to believe me because you're basically going to get a repeat of her talk. Where I'm going to argue we should get rid of everything except for functions, basically. What qualifies me to talk about the next great programming language? Absolutely nothing. Quite seriously, I'm not even a programming language designer like Andy. So, absolutely no qualifications here, except I have been writing code for a very long time. And from the perspective of someone who has written 3 million lines of really bad code, and maybe a few hundred lines of good code, I do have some opinions about what I want from a programming language. So, I'm going to take it as a given that we want static typing and purity, which is, I guess, the one difference from Andy's talk. And I'm going to look at the programming languages, the leading statically typed programming languages instead. And we have ML and its variants, SML and so forth. We have Haskell and we have OCaml. And one of the really interesting things about all these languages is that they are decades old. And they were really old languages. Technically, OCaml was invented in 1996, but if you consider it's basically just an extension to CAML, which is an extension to SML, which is an extension of ML, almost all these programming languages really do go back decades. And Haskell is, in my opinion, probably the best statically typed programming language for getting stuff done. And it also happens to be my personal favorite programming language. So I'm going to take the opportunity to pick on it a bit. It turns out that, despite the fact that I love Haskell, there is no such thing as Haskell. And that's sort of because the last definition of the language is too crippled for people to write programs in, so we have to use extensions, and GHC supplies us with, I think, around 70 different extensions. And these can be used in almost any possible combination, so there's no one definition of the language Haskell. In fact, I actually had to look up how to pronounce this number because I wasn't sure. There were so many zeros. There are 144 quadrillion flavors of Haskell. I know some imply others. Oh, okay, so it's not quite that bad. But fundamentally, this isn't a language. This is a very large family of languages. And some of these extensions, they're not so great. Oh, let's choose incoherent instances and combine that with undecidable instances. And maybe we'll add in overlapping instances just for the heck of it. And some of these are great, some of these are not so great. There is no language here. There's a bunch of different languages. And one of my contentions is that even for Haskell, our very best functional programming languages suffer from basically decades worth of accretion. They had a core that was designed a really long time ago. And individual features were designed, but they were piled on one after another, after another, after another, until we end up with the GHC situation, which is 70 different extensions that all take the language in these random different ways. It wasn't designed all together as a coherent whole. And that's something I'm very interested in because I know there's been a bunch of development. Like, we've actually made progress in understanding type theory and learning about functional programming. And we've written programs. We've written programs that in some cases are hundreds of thousands of lines of Haskell code. And so we have a lot of experience. Academic research has pushed state of the art. So I'm very much interested in what would it look like if we set out to design a functional programming language from the ground up. And just threw out all the assumptions, every single thing. Because I think some of the features in languages like Haskell contaminate our minds. And we can't even see them anymore because we just take them for granted. We're so used to it. Like, you get indoctrinated into FP, and then suddenly all you can see, you view the world through the lens that is ML and Haskell or whatever your functional programming language of choice is. So, what about Idris? Well, Idris is a modern functional programming language and was designed sort of with the benefit of a lot of the research that's been done in type theory. Unfortunately, Idris is a research language, and it's more a test bed for experimenting with new ideas. It's not really designed, at this point anyway, to be a language I can take out into my day job and write production systems with. And nor am I convinced that the Idris approach, as much as I like it, is going to be the next big thing. Actually, I quite think that it won't be. But I could be wrong, and I would love to be proven wrong on that side. So what is there? I honestly don't know. There's nothing out there that strikes me as capable of being the next great functional programming language, which is perhaps why we're all using Haskell or OCaml or Scala or Lisp or Scheme or Racket. We're all using these languages that go back decades and decades. So, I'm going to be talking about my ideal functional programming language. Let me talk about the stuff I'd throw out. And I'm going to do this one at a time. And I'm going to do it in such a way that hopefully most of you will agree with me in the beginning and not heckle me. And towards the end, all of you will be throwing tomatoes at me. Pattern matching, I vote no. I vote no on pattern matching. And the reason for that is it's just another ad hoc thing thrown into a language that doesn't need it. In fact, we can do pattern matching in quotes, entirely with other mechanisms in a language like Haskell. Example is lenses and prisms and type classes. And those features allow us to implement something that is as powerful, actually more powerful than pattern matching, because it's extensible, it's general, and it's implemented in terms of other features of the language. And that's an example of using the Haskell total or totally package, as well as some prisms that you should look up. I mean, amazing stuff, and it proves we don't really need pattern matching to get even pattern matching like syntax. So let's chop that one over the window and instead adopt like first class pattern matching, which would be pattern matching implemented with other constructs of the language.
Jump in.
Records.
Jump in.
Yes.
I don't know if you wanted to bring up for later, but how could the compiler check coverage of case?
It's possible. We'll talk after.
Okay.
So records. I'm going to say that let's throw out records because, like Andy pointed out, record is basically a function from an identifier to some other value. And in fact, we can implement records in any dependently typed variable or in any dependently typed programming language. And even in a pseudo-dependently typed programming language like Scala, we can implement records as first-class citizens, basically as partial functions from strings to values. And we can do that in a totally type-safe way that allows us to extend records and delete fields, manipulate them, smash them together, do stuff that is totally impossible with all the records in Haskell and PureScript and languages like that. And we can do it because these are first-class constructs that only require use of a dependently typed programming language. And you're going to complain about the syntax, well, I have more to say on that. But fundamentally, you could make this as pretty as you want it. You could use any syntax if you want it. If you wanted to give it syntax, it doesn't need to be this hideous, bulky thing. But what I want to argue for is there should be no such thing as a record. It's just a, sort of a partial function from an identifier or a string or whatever you want to call it to a value. Modules. I am actually not a big fan of modules. And so I'm going to toss them out of my ideal functional programming language. This is a module in SML, and I've actually yet to find a case where I needed or could benefit from a module. In this particular example, I take a stack and I make a generic definition of a stack. This is using PureScript. I make a generic definition of a stack that can create new things, push things, and pop things on the stack, and do that completely independently of the representation of a stack. And I can pass this around. In this example, I'm using PureScript because PureScript has records and Haskell doesn't have records. But again, if you're working with a dependently typed language, then these records would be implemented in terms of other features of the language. So here's my generic function do some stack stuff, which all it requires is a stack module, and it can do a whole bunch of stuff and end up producing some result using that generic stack. And you say, well, that's not quite fair because you can do other things with modules that you can't do with this sort of polymorphic encoding. And maybe that's true, but I've yet to find an example of a compelling example of something that I couldn't emulate using other features of the language. In this example, I have a reservation system which requires a stack module. It doesn't care what sort of stack module, and it's going to end up returning some sort of generic module for a reservation system. So I've expressed a dependency from one module to another, and I've done it using other mechanisms of the language. In fact, I've never seen a compelling example of a single thing in which modules were like real first-class modules were the superior choice for implementing some functionality.
So in order to get that, you need higher ranked types, though.
That's correct.
And the reason you need that is because you're scolemizing an existential, whereas a module would have made it first class.
Yes, so I don't see the need for something like a module when I can implement it in terms of rank n types. Syntax. So this is where hopefully I'll get more than Daniel heckling me. I'm going to argue that we throw away syntax entirely. And he actually not clapping. What's wrong with you guys? I'm going to argue that we stop pretending that programs are strings of ASCII characters, because they aren't. And almost every single feature of today's languages are workarounds for the fact that our programs are strings of ASCII characters. And that includes implicits. And the order of functions parameters, which is crazy, and compiler errors, and funny-looking symbols, and scopes, and modules, that is Haskell-style non-modules, and imports, and name clashes, and holes, and a whole host of other language features that consume so much of what it means for a language to be familiar to us. They're all based on the assumption that programs are strings of ASCII characters.
So wait, what do we have to write as
heckle time?
I'm going to talk about some of the things I want at the end, so okay. I'll get to that. Partiality. Yes. Two hecklers.
I actually don't want to ask this question. I want somebody that knows SML better than me. Does anybody want to make the point about generativity for the modules part? Nobody?
All right, fine. I will.
How do you enforce non-interference between differently instantiated versions of a module?
You're going to get that with the extension.
Are you?
What you won't get is the non-generative ones that sometimes people want.
We
can use existentials that gives you generativity.
Okay.
Can get existentials
some
from rank
n. Some people want the other version, though, and this won't give you that.
One reason is that in OCaml, for example, you use modules as a way of determining which files to load. You don't tell the compiler what files are in the program. It uses the module identifiers to figure out what to load. So if you take out the modules as part of something the type system knows about, then you're going to have to supply the ability literally for the compiler to load a file some other way.
But we don't have files because we don't have text, so it's great.
No code, life is better.
Heckle away.
So how do you, so with respect to the ASCII point, how do you answer the objection that human language for millennia has trended from pictographs to ideograms to alphabetized systems? I mean, ASCII is literally the culmination of millions of years of linguistic evolution.
Congratulations!
I propose we represent our programs as Gödel numbers.
You're assuming that programs are language.
I'm assuming that programs are ideas that are communicated by language.
Yes, but ideas don't treat with language.
So fundamentally,
they don't.
The idea of throwing away ASCII or you know, separating it from asking.
I
think unless you have a compelling way to teach this as a language, because regardless of whether or not we agree that it's a string of ASCII characters, whatever we write is a language. Like we're using the language.
I'm thinking of digital environments in which you construct things by a method, strings, a method very similar to, if you've seen demos of like a Unison, for example, what Paul Giussano was working on, something of that order where you construct programs sort of at a high level and you fill in holes.
You had
holes
on that
way
list.
Of
you had holes on that list.
No, different type of holes. So partiality, and my argument for that is
very simple. Sure.
It's partial, it's not a damn function. Sorry. I'm typing. So hopefully I'm going to get a number of people objecting to this one.
Don't want names for things?
Well, we can't name things if we don't have characters, right?
There we have a type called EL and a type called DOM-ID and types called positive and negative and dress size. And they differ in one respect, the names. And if I take away the names, well. If I take away the names, what does this stuff even mean?
Less.
How do you do units of measure? How do you have any sort of type safety whatsoever in that?
How do you not cry every night?
You can generalize my Michael to that.
Program like that, question mark. Units of measure have laws that affect their composition. They compose into other things. And that's the means by which I want to capture. Yes. So what I want to do is stop pretending that differences in names actually matter. And I want, when you see code like this, you should see string and you should see float. And the fact that I call one an email and one a DOM ID doesn't really make a bit of difference. Now, I'm not arguing not to use new types and data and new names in Haskell today. I'm arguing that fundamentally in some future language, we're not going to have to do that. Yes?
My only library in Hackage has like 100 and some odd lines of new types, so you're banned from using it. You never need to worry about it. I hope you don't need to use Elasticsearch, because that's your only way.
So I love new types. I love new types. I use them all the time.
So you like nominative typing. Process.
No, I'm arguing that this is the compromise we have to deal with.
There's an argument in favor of this. Imagine that a type declaration for emails came with a regex to recognize a valid email, and that was checked automatically as part of the type. And now I've restricted to even creating that this regex did, and so we have smart constructors built into the language.
Smart constructors, that's how we work around this problem.
But if they were built into the language, then sort of at the type level,
exactly.
That would be maybe one of the
But then how would you refer to one of those?
You could still call it an email, but it wouldn't be a new type for string anymore. It would be something that had guarantees in the language.
You just have to write the regex every time you want to use the regex.
Nice. So let me actually take this a little further and play a guessing game. I've taken two of those types from the preceding slide, and I've done some liquid Haskell type stuff off to the side. What do you think that first one is?
Positive.
What do you think that second one is?
Negative.
Damn right. And you did that, strictly negative. You did that without having to look at a name. Yes.
We have to look at float. I was going to say float and string are just names for different representations of bytes. So at some point, you have to have a name.
Hey, we're back to Girdle numbers.
To help you remember what the properties are. That's the only reason. Names to help you remember what the properties are. But fundamentally, float shouldn't have any special denotations.
But I would be really annoyed if I had to, every time I was reading and referring to a positive number, I had to parse and go, okay, greater than
so,
this.
So the point is, in my visual programming environment, I can look at something and it's called an email, and if I don't know what it is, then I can go to that alias, whatever it is, and I can find out what it means to be an email. And fundamentally, the difference is about laws and properties, and grant properties, and it's not about the need.
Yeah.
But isn't that just like jumping to a definition? And I'm truly heckling right now.
So if I jump to the definition of this email, what am I going to find? I'm going to find a string. But if I jump to the definition, let's say I have something called positive over here, and I jump to its definition, what am I going to find? I'm going to find that property.
Well, so in whatever language you were just talking about, though, because like certain languages, the definition of email could capture that pretty succinctly in
its name. And if it does, then that's awesome. Yes.
I think another place this goes to is isomorphisms, right? Because I may define a type that is email that has some certain set of laws, and you know Greg may define a type that has some certain set of laws. And if the laws are identical, then those types should be considered isomorphic, right? It doesn't matter what they're called.
See also my argument against
operations
of types.
Oh, yeah. Right? We have many numbers that are all isomorphic to each other in terms of set theoretically. They have the same, you know, level of infinity of inhabitants. But you know, I can take a pair of numbers and put one over the other, and that's irrational, and I can put them next to each other and it's a complex. And they're the same representation, they have the same number of inhabitants, but they have different meanings to the operations assigned to them. So if you talk only about the properties of the inhabitants, that's not sufficient. You have to talk about things and their operations together.
Yes.
So let's say that I have a program with a last name type and also a city type. These are both strings. You can't distinguish between them on patterns. Houston is a valid thing for both. How do I keep myself as the programmer from accidentally mixing them up?
Provenance.
What?
Provenance. So. My program is tracking all the way from the beginning whether these things come from a database or something else. To the program, it's agnostic. Is it a city? Or is it a first name? Or is it a last name? Like, what matters? We don't need names for these things. What we need is a program that allows us, or rather a programming language that allows us to capture the fact that these came from different places. So capture the lineage of that, where did that came from, and then propagate that in a type-safe fashion throughout my entire program. So my program, I look at this stuff, and it prevents me from mixing an email in a city, but not because one is called an email in a city, but because those things are different because they have different provenance that goes all the way back to wherever they came.
Are you saying providence or provenance?
Provenance. I'm sorry. Yes.
What if you have some common ontology? So you could actually like parse a scientific paper and produce a program model. Like so some people do that for their job. Like, they read a paper and they try to understand that. We saw it on the blogs like crypto, they built a like DSL so they could map this easier in their head, but they're still interested to ask. What if you have some kind of like things to map the ontology instead of characters?
I think there are different ways of getting fundamentally finite ontology will run into sort of these problems, and I would prefer the distinctions between types to be captured by formal properties. Rather than names. That's my only point.
It's like this is complementary.
It could be. I have to dig more into what you're talking about.
Yeah.
Yes.
Are you okay with names being attached as metadata?
In the form of provenance.
So for provenance, that makes sense if your data is coming from some external source, but. Like in the case of Bloodhound, it's just a DSL, you just construct values, but it's Elasticsearch, so everything's like string, number, string, 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 string. There's no provenance. So how do I prevent transposition errors?
Well,
I mean, do you want me to like make a graph is graph with types and then like?
First
we kill Elasticsearch.
Oh yeah, no, that's
good. What is the type of
problem? So someone's entering in.
First we kill Elasticsearch.
What's that?
Oh yeah.
You're generating data to send to someone else, and use name fields in your non-records to get the equivalent of name.
Oh my god.
So for example, in an independent list type programming language, one way you can annotate your data with metadata is just using a string, you know, or whatever, however you represent strings.
But the strings are names.
And that becomes part of its size. Yes. So I think I don't think you need anything special to model that. But I think the vast majority of cases can be captured using either a notion of provenance, where did it come from, or a notion of properties, what are the properties.
Can I convince you to make a church encoding of the library? I would like to see that.
In Haskell, there are reasons we have new types, and you should use new types. If you're using Haskell or pure script, you should use data. So all this stuff that I'm talking about doesn't apply to current languages.
So basically, you just hate humanity. Everything.
Now I've got this whole I can return to Barnum.
Please do.
This is data. This is what you see when you create a data type and ask. This is what I want you to see, this nasty stuff with the plot.
That's nasty.
It is. That is C, for those of you who are recent programmers. I've been programming for 20 plus years, so.
You went to school.
Yeah, that's right. When I construct a data type called either, I'm talking about bits in memory. There's a reason this thing is called tag union. And it's because in C, you would implement it as a tag union. You would have this little tag thing that tells you which different branch of your union contains valid data. And of course, we've improved many, many, many times upon that. But fundamentally,
that code is, you actually would only have one void pointer. Because the tag would tell you whether it was the left or the right.
Yeah.
Fair enough. Yes. So, but in any case, what is either except describing to me how I'm going to lay stuff out in memory? But I'm not ready to. I'll take your heckling in a second. Two slides, and you can heckle away. So. I create one of these data types, and what's the first thing that we do when we learn functional programming?
Pattern match.
We start pattern matching, yes. Yes, boo. Because pattern matching is super fun when you start programming functionally. It's like, wow, I didn't know this was possible. And so you pattern match all the frickin' time. And you pattern match so often, and then you eventually run into sort of problems with that. I didn't cover all my cases, or duplicating code in this case, in this case, in this case. And then eventually, you get the bright idea to go pro and start describing your code in terms of catamorphisms or some other type of morph, some fold over the data structure. And so you create this handy function called fold, and you discover how powerful it is, and you start using that in lieu of pattern matching. And you still have to use pattern matching to implement your definition of fold, but after you've got this definition of fold, now it's just mega powerful and composes with other folds and has all these other cool properties. Well, what if we just skipped that intermediate step and went directly to defining our data structure in terms of a fold? Well, that's called church encoding, as most of you probably know. And or it's a version of church encoding. And there I've constructed a list that is nothing more than a fold. And once I have this definition of a list, I can construct nil and cons. And I can do all the sorts of same things that I would be able to do if I were pattern matching against bits and laid out in memory.
second.
And you have to ask yourself, like, at the foreign boundary, if I'm passing one of these lists into a function, or I'm reading it, or I'm getting it from some external source, how is it represented? Could be an array. Could be a linked list. It could be a vector. It could be skip list. It could be any one of a number of different things. What I've done here is I've moved from bits in memory layout to a capability-based description of what a fold is. This description of a list tells me what it looks like when it's laid out in memory. And this description of a list tells me what I can do with it, what capabilities that gives me, and in fact, I can fold it. So yes?
Towards the end, when you showed the functions with nil and cons, that sort of approaches a visual representation of the concept of, like, I'm going to say either or maybe or something like that, but I would argue that the thing that you said describes the bits also describes the decision more visually than this. Like, I see two functions, I see something on the right-hand side that doesn't help me conceptualize the different cases.
That's just familiarity.
Familiarity and tooling. So we're talking about syntax here. This is how I represented it in this ASCII string of characters that, which I've argued against.
Just familiarity.
Yeah, but I'm just saying that I encode probably a quarter of my data types like this rather than the data types. I just hope that I have more so.
It is.
Kind of morphisms are awesome.
And by the way, I know this is strictly more powerful than the list I defined, and that's sort of the point down there at the bottom. Yes.
So, basically, what you're saying is you want a dependently typed lambda calculus with de Brown notation.
I don't know. Maybe.
Yeah. I mean, you're talking about church encoding everything
that already exists,
deleting
everything that language.
Yeah.
Nobody's stopping you.
Yeah.
What's wrong with knowing how your bits are laid out in memory?
That's just a presentation detail. If you want a different representation.
Yeah, but like how your program performs might be.
So I'm unconcerned with syntax. So if you had some, if you wanted syntax, which I don't, you could have some syntax for describing data structures as this or this. But fundamentally, what I want that to be is nothing more than a function.
So what do you do at the limit? What do you do with stuff that's only sending something to a human? Images, audio, that kind of stuff.
What do you mean, what do I?
Well, if we're running linear data simply as functions, there are things that we would normally lay those bits in memory that are only meaningful when translating something for a human.
So we can do that by defining a byte, for example, and then defining a list of bytes.
Okay, so you define those things in terms of this.
Yes.
I think that this could make an incredible core language for your thing. So if you look at Idris, you can look at DP, which is the core language, and it's basically what you're saying, but with patterns instead of church encoding, so you have your language. But I would argue that that language is completely difficult to learn and to understand. Even if you have visual things, this is not a list conceptually. So this is strictly more powerful, and you can generate it from the description of a list. So why would you expose this? So I don't get why you want to go. For me, this looks like going to low-level functional programming. So this is like assembly of programming instead of high-level.
So I'm fundamentally concerned. Like, I don't care if there's some higher-level interface, whether it's a data declaration or whatever it is. Fundamentally, I'm concerned that that thing, whatever it is like, if you want syntax, and you're arguing basically for syntax, if you want syntax, it should merely be syntax for a function.
Yes, but what I'm arguing is exactly a language is the syntax that you give, not the core of the implementation. So what I'm saying is, this is very nice. It's a way to implement your language, and I'm sure this gives you a lot of interoperability niceness, but this doesn't solve you the problem on how the next functional programming language is going to look like, because
look like.
Something has to happen to find that, right?
Look like. It's not going to look like this. It's not going to look like this. I don't know exactly what it's going to look like.
So the living lady is going to be the other person who's going to be the
program. It's outsourced. You want your syntax, I understand. I appreciate
this.
Yeah.
Of visual things. I tried a couple of structured Haskell modes where you change the ASP, and I find it so complicated to use.
So composability is basically related to the regularity of shapes. And if your things are very regular, if you only have one thing, then it maximizes your composability. Even though in like TT, as you point out, or actually TT doesn't have this representation, but theoretically in some programming language like Haskell could have this core representation. But fundamentally, if it exposes that in a different way, as a different kind in the host language, then it will stop composing with all the other things because you have this kind of stuff, and stuff composes in there, and this kind of stuff and composes in there. I'm very, very interested in the property of universal composability. Yeah.
So I wonder, is there a little bit of baby semantic trickery going on here? So right now you're saying you've got these.
But I do have more slides to get through.
Oh, you're
trying
to
play.
We're already
this
at
one
10
slide.
Past the hour.
What's that?
We're already at 6:10. So.
Save. Yeah.
There's nobody to stop you from going over. So if you got something that has names, okay, and if those names have to be representative of how they're laid out in memory, but they don't have to be, right? And then you assign those names capabilities. But what you're saying is you have a list of capabilities, and at some point you have to reference it by something, so that you could give it a list of ASCII characters that's list, or you could give it a picture of a list, or I have no idea. But something that becomes a language that's referencing this thing, it just seems like a reversal of how we define things, but that could be done in the implementation.
It's so weird the way we do this, because we do define this data structure, and then, you know, if you've been functionally programming for a while, almost the first thing you do is create a folder over it, or use some generic mechanism for doing that for you, and then you oftentimes interact with the fold more than the other. I look at this type definition, and it tells me everything I need to know to use this thing. It tells me exactly what I can do with it. And I don't need to know anything about how those bits are laid out in memory, whether it's array or linked list or whatever. Yeah.
So I want to respond to the thing you said, actually. And this might not be the thing John's thinking, but you mentioned this idea that what John has identified is almost more like functional assembly than something you can actually use. In order to use it, you'd have to build something on top of it, and you'd only be interacting with that thing you built on top, because John thing is too basic. So and at that point, the thing you built on top basically becomes the language. But I would actually argue that's okay, because it's still useful to have built it on top of this expressive substrate. That's actually something I was trying very hard to do with Emily. I was emphasizing in my talk the C expression stuff, just you can do everything with application. But the thing that's interesting to me is I have to build this entire language on top of the application. But I couldn't imagine building a separate, different language on top of it that could still potentially talk to the first one, because they're both basically based on applications, and they both have enough type knowledge to maybe convert between the two representations, I think. So at that point, you've actually still done something useful, because I don't think you want the same thing all the time. I don't think two programs always want the same thing. And I think that if you argue that, I'm going to ask you for a Haskell program and how many DSLs you've written. But there is a thing like, in Haskell, you're building the DSLs on top of something pretty complicated. DSLs are on top of Haskell. And when I see people design Haskell DSLs, it's the form of the fact it has to fit inside Haskell syntax. But if instead, Haskell was built on this one simple functional ASM, and your other thing was your DSL was built on this functional ASM, but you have some way to stitch the two together because they have a common substrate, you've just done something very useful.
But that, as it transpires, Haskell is built on such a functional core. It's called System FC, or F Omega C, and it's pretty well studied, and there's a number of papers about it. So all those extensions desugar to a relatively small core, and SPJ has said that's the only reason he believes it's okay to have this many extensions, is because that small functional core acts as sort of a consistency check on all the insane incoherent things you might want to do on top of that. I will point out, of the functional languages represented at this conference, I think there's only one of them that doesn't have anything resembling a core that it desugars to. That language starts with an S, ends with an A.
They're working on it. They're working on that.
Yeah. No recursion? We're out of here.
Wild loops.
I know. Too wild.
Could support general recursion, and you could have like some context, like some kind of macro that restricts a subset of language. I don't see why you'd want like to bake in the language like you can't do general recursion, because like in some case you might want to do it. Why not just have like the normal sort of like constraint of the language say that you can't do it, but you can always sort of get out of it.
So the idea of language modes is one I'll return to.
What are the things? What are the things to think about is that you're talking about baking into the language a constraint that you can't do general recursion. We all of our languages bake it in a constraint that you can do general recursion, and that is actually a profoundly weird thing, right? Really profoundly weird.
That's also a mistake. I just want to be able to do both, right?
Yeah. So recursions used to do two things. Induction, you have this big old thing or a number or whatever it is, and you break it down into smaller and smaller bits, and you express your algorithm that way. And that's pretty easy, right? Because what you can do is, if you define your data structures using search encoding, then the act of creating that data, whatever it was, builds up the energy, if you want to think of like potential energy in physics, necessary to deconstruct it. So for example, using that definition of fold for a list and the definition of cons I gave you, if you use that to do A cons, B cons, C cons, D cons, nil, you end up building in the capacity of that data structure to go basically repeat something, you know, four times or whatever it is I just said. So induction on data structures, expressing algorithms on data structures using induction is easy, and you don't need general recursion. You're coding all your data structures. It's just fold.
I'm thinking about asking, but maybe you'll answer it. So I don't know.
Okay.
I'll ask it later if I have to.
So what about co-induction? And this is the really sort of tricky part, because co-induction is like you're describing something that could potentially be infinite, and of course Haskell makes it super easy to do that anywhere, because everything is non-strict, even in ways you shouldn't. But if you don't have recursion, then you end up defining a state machine instead. And it's basically an unfold, and this is your definition. And things like this are not powerful enough to represent arbitrary co-induction. But if you increase the power of your type system, and it would have to be dependently typed, such that you can do things like session types, and like the type that you get out can be different than the type that you get in, although you can provably accept that same type through the next pass, then you can end up expressing what this amounts to, which is a description of a program that can be run externally and potentially continue on forever, and independently type, or in total functional programming languages, that's sort of how you have to model infinite processes anyway. So adding the further restriction that you can't do recursion just seems relatively minor on top of that. And the advantage to something like this is I can look at this and I can understand. This, even if it creates this infinite thing, I can look at any definition of this function and I can pretty simply understand it. And yes, it's going to make some things harder. It's going to make certain compositions, certain algorithms harder to describe. But I can describe it like this. And once I've done that, like the complexity for me, the mental complexity, is going to be bounded. Whereas going back to this example here, which this thing might be co-inductive, or I don't know. I honestly have no idea. It doesn't terminate, so someone proved it.
They're all recursive cases, John.
So,
yes.
All right, I'm going to ask it. Do you want this language to be restricted to only programs that can be proven to terminate? Or not terminate?
Well, the co-induction means that you can write a program that is co-inductive, so it can go on forever, but to be productive, you always have to do something.
Okay, so, but it's... But then, without general recursion, the language would be provable. One would, like, it'd be provable any program would either terminate or not terminate.
Using induction, you know that it will terminate. Using co-induction, you know that you're always making progress.
Okay.
So that the function you're running over the stream, potentially infinite stream, is doing something.
Depends on you.
But yeah. Total on like a piecework basis.
Okay.
So what is my ideal functional programming language? Like, and this only take 5 minutes.
Look like?
I know I went way, way, way over. Yeah.
Does your ideal functional programming language look like another programmer that you tell what to program?
Maybe.
I think so.
So it's layered like an onion. I want to sub Turing-complete part.
Okay.
And I honestly think that we don't need Turing-completeness to do 95, maybe even 99.99% of programming. It's just like all the business apps I write and like anything written using Reactive and yes, all sorts of programs can be written.
You can't prove that, Brian.
give me an example of a program I cannot write without Turing. And I'll write it. I'll write it.
A compiler for your language.
JavaScript interpreter.
I have I have an idea for the onions. We can declare which part of the onion we're using. We'll call them pragmas. We'll put them at the top of the file.
Haskell's my favorite programming language. Well, it should be. So sub Turing complete part, and you can prove and optimize a whole lot more. It's super rich. You can do amazing things with this sub Turing complete part, and you can write the vast majority of your program in it. And then there's sort of this other part where you lose the ability to prove things. Your optimizations don't become as powerful. Abstraction has a cost, but you can like drive that pure sub Turing part by feeding the inputs or like doing all the other sorts of messy things.
Sounds like the I.O. monad.
Except like the I.O. monad is enormous.
It's the partiality monad, yeah.
Yeah, the partiality monad.
If you have code data, then you can do that.
that's our one, and I almost want it to be like painful to use that driver part of the language because I want people to be forced to write it.
I think that's going to be easier because everything is going to be so.
I can see that. I want a structured editor, and I want it to be visual. And you've seen sort of demos of what this could look like. I really think this is the future of functional programming, and I think it has the capacity to make functional programming truly friendly. And one of the things that I see is like people will write blah 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 blah, and then they'll compile it, and the compiler will beat you up on the head for doing something that it allowed you to type. And of course, it does that because it has no control over what you put into a file. But fundamentally, it doesn't have to be that way. We can construct, we can whatever sort of programming environment this is, we can only allow the construction of things which are type safe and eliminate compiler errors.
All right, Vim or Emacs keybinds.
Seriously, John, have you looked at Unison?
I have.
Yeah, because Unison does exactly that.
I'm a huge fan of Project, and that's one of my inspirations at the end. Yes?
I would argue that still it's nice to be able to write something that is incomplete.
Right.
So if you only allow, no, but it's not holes. It's like I comment this line, and this complete that you can do
about
anything.
That
like I comment this line on this thing, and
I
this
thought
is
about
useful.
That a lot. And I agree it's useful, but I think this is one of the things that comes down to. I'm used to programming with strings of characters, and I know how to incrementally solve a problem doing that, and sometimes it's by counting stuff out, and sometimes it's by writing lots of broken stuff, because that gives me the shape of the big picture, but I think that I would become accustomed to using something like Unison, except, you know, the next generation, or maybe five generations away from whatever Unison will be. I think it will form its own sort of idioms that allow you to do similar things and have conceptual holes in here and have sort of big picture ideas in your head. It's going to be represented differently, but it will enable people to come to the language and not have to deal with all these compilation errors that happen when we allow people to enter arbitrary strings of text and we try to pretend that there's something more than
I have points. To agree with that. In fact, I think that to some extent that happens for people who use IDEs. It's like you're programming Java, then you're at
right.
You tell them to create getters and setters, create constructors. You're not typing that. You're going to the token, the thing that's correct directly. And that's, I think that's the part.
But
you transcend the ASCII and you say, I want a constructor, I want a getter and setter.
But even with ASCII, if you
and
use IntelliJ,
you're not going to do that because it's not going to have either getter and setters or a constructor.
I never get a compiler error in Java if I'm using IntelliJ because it warns me before I even click save. So if it just didn't let me click save when things were still red, I would never get a compiler error.
This could create tremendous problems for somebody that's either learning a language or learning something in a language. Because if they're not allowed to pose an incorrect construction and be told why it was wrong, then how do they learn what the right thing is, other than just constructive examples? When
so
people are learning things,
know,
they need correct
zero
and incorrect examples.
0 years of experience in structured program editing that we have. If you consider math to be a programming language, we have hundreds or thousands of years of experience with that. So we know what teaching people looks like. I don't know what teaching people looks like if it's a structured environment.
Yeah.
How to teach them to learn incrementally.
So an editing environment is something like this, or a custom text where the machines and basically built in but didn't have the RAM to
hold the text. So I apologize for my waiver. I'm going to fast forward through this. I only have like two more slides, and then we can chat out. So a structured editor destroys the motivation for almost all of our language features. So many language features are implemented because people like syntax. People want this and this and this and this. And they exist because we edit strings of ASCII characters. A lot of the features like don't even need to exist.
The one
true.
So I want everything to be functions, and I want these to be math functions. I'm tired of programming languages where we have things that are not values that cannot be used in the domain and codomain of functions. And of course, that means we need it to be dependently typed because we need functions that contain types and values and return types or values. And I think truly reaching this goal would eliminate a lot of the incidental complexity that comes from programming, just because there are so many irregularly shaped things. Like fundamentally, so many constructs in functional programming language work around the fact that we don't have truly powerful like math-like functions in which everything can be, everything in the language can be part of the domain or codomain. I want proof search. So I think that proof search is the future of functional programming. And the reasons for that are many. Computer proofs are being used to generate so massive databases of information that humans cannot prove by themselves. A lot of like proofs constructed by mathematicians for some theorems are now at least computer assisted. And the amount of information necessary to prove some of these things is huge. So I want proof search. I want it to be Turing-complete, because if it's not the computer trying, possibly in vain, to prove something, this could be me. Like if a given problem is in fact Turing-complete, I would rather put that work off to the compiler. I want levels of proof. Something is proven true, or there's evidence for it, i.e., you know, quick check style evidence, but it's not proven true. So I can choose to possibly run programs that aren't necessarily proven correct, but haven't been proven incorrect yet. And I want, of course, proven false. I want proof databases to exist and to be persistent, so that when I recompile it, I don't have to regenerate all the proofs that I've gone through before, which is what every single programming language gets wrong. Every single dependently typed programming language gets wrong that I'm aware of. So they're infinite. And I want people to actually take advantage of research, for example, in machine learning and deep learning, to accelerate the searching through these huge graphs to reach certain conclusions. And zero cost abstraction, and actually some of that
so you want
comes
that.
For free from picking out recursion and using Turing coding to do a lot. With that, you can actually figure out what the program means, fully expand it, and reduce it again to an optimized form. And you have that ability because you're not allowed to generate recursion in recursion coding everything. These are my inspirations. So Unison, I fully approve of that project. Hope it goes somewhere. Liquid Haskell and more by Gabriel Gonzalez. Cool stuff. And I don't claim to have all the answers. I'm probably 50% wrong on all of this, at least, which means I'm maybe 50% right on the other half. So thank you very much for putting up with me.